There's a lover in the story, but the story's still the same. There's a lullaby for suffering and a paradox to blame. But it's written in the scriptures and it's not some idle claim. You want it darker? We kill the flame. They're lining up the prisoners and the guards are taking aim. I struggled with some demons, they were middle class and tame. I didn't know I had permission to murder and to maim. You want it darker? I'm ready, my lord.
Slashaholics, welcome to episode 15 of Out of Print Slashers. I am Sean Campbell. I am here with the 80s slasher librarian, Josh LaRue. How you doing tonight?
Doing good, Sean.
Excellent. Tonight we are going to be reviewing book two of the Halloween series by Kelly O'Rourke, which is called The Old Myers Place. I remember this not being one of my favorites, but I couldn't exactly put my finger on it. I just remember after listening to you narrate it, it made me so furious that I wrote a fan ending to it and sent it to you because you were angry at the ending. And I went back and re-listened to it, and it's,
I'm going to remind me, and I'll put a little thing up on the top of the video here for the epilogue that you wrote.
Yeah.
It'll pop up right there. And then at the end of the video, I'll put a link to the unabridged version of the book and your ending, alternate ending. And before we get too into this, guys, we'll remind you at the end, but on After the Slash tonight, we're going to be joined by Jason Brooks. He played Jason in the fan film Vengeance, where CJ Graham starred as Elias Voorhees. That's going to be exclusively on Patreon, so if you haven't signed up yet and you want to get some awesome early access stuff, some free ebooks, free merch, all that kind of cool stuff, sign up. You'll be supporting the channel, and when you sign up, you'll have access to an entire catalog of episodes, every episode of After the Slash we've done so far, and every episode to come.
You wouldn't be trying to do no product placement, are you?
Just a little bit. I'm looking forward to talking to Jason Brooks. That's going to be fun.
Yeah, that'll be really cool. I love that movie.
Next week here on Out of Print Slashers, we're going to have Vincent DeSante.
Yes.
And he's the man behind Never Hike Alone and the upcoming Never Hike in the Snow. I hope I'm saying the title right. And after that, the next week, we've got David Bergantino stopping back in to discuss Freddy Krueger's Tales of Terror, Deadly Disguise. And Sean, the week after that's a big one. We're going to be joined by Tom McLaughlin, the writer and director of Friday the 13th 6, Jason Lives, will be discussing the novelization in the movie. I am super excited for that one.
Absolutely.
I've sent out an invitation to CJ Graham. I don't know, haven't heard back yet, but Tom will be here regardless. So it'd be cool to get both of them, but Tom is going to be here. July 2.
We need to do like they do in radio stations where you have a guest on, you give them the cup that has the station's logo on it so they can drink their coffee. Since we're in this time of having to be stuck at home, it'd be great if we could like send these to people and say like, hey, when you do the interview with us, can you drink a coffee? Like we just gave it to you. Like you just sat down, like simulate the coffee.
I ought to send out coffee cups to everybody that's going to be on the show. I got some good ones on the merch store. Oh, I've got a new design being made that's going to be out sometime this summer. And it's going to be like I'm being attacked by a freaking fly here. Get off of me. It's going to be a martini glass full of blood with like an olive, you know, on a toothpick or whatever. And yeah. blood's going to be dripping out of the glass onto a knife. And the shirt's going to say, I am a slashaholic.
Yeah. You know what we should do?
Like, hi, I'm Sean, and I am a slashaholic. You know, something like that. So
we should do T-shirts for our guests that say, I was on Out of Print Slashers, and all I got was this T-shirt.
Yeah, because that's never, you know, that's original. Nobody's ever thought of that before. Good one there.
Yeah. All right. So
that's what makes it good.
Halloween, the old Myers place.
Yes, sir.
My
least favorite of the three. The characters, in my opinion, are very unlikable in this one. There's not a whole lot of redeeming qualities in most of the characters. Would you agree?
Yeah. Normally, when you have a main character, you're obligated to feel something for that character. But there are some movies and some books where, start to finish, I don't like the main character. And sometimes they're written that way. A Clockwork Orange, American Psycho, you're not supposed to like those characters. They're supposed to be archetypes and stereotypes, so they can dissect them. But in this one, Mary, the main girl, I didn't feel anything for her, even when she has the typical arc of standing up for herself and arming herself to take down the villain. I still didn't care for her at all.
And it's funny you mention stories where it's written that way. And then you have stuff like The Shield and Sons of Anarchy, where you have characters that are written for you that you're not supposed to like them. Breaking Bad. You know, Breaking Bad's another one. You're not supposed to like your main characters, but you end up rooting for them anyways. This is not that. I got through this one simply because I promised I was going to narrate it. But this, honestly, is pretty low on my list of the 50 I've done. Probably only the ones worse than this one, in my opinion, are probably Hell Lake, Death Moon. I mean, I'm not saying it's as bad as those. It's not a bad, horrible book, but it's not my favorite.
It reminded me of, you remember, before I get into that, Michael's not in this book much. He's in a dream sequence. You think you see him, but it's not him. He comes about halfway through the book and on. It reminds me of Jason X. To the experiment, where Jason spends about half the book strapped to a table, like, I'd rather not spend the rest of this novel tied to this fucking table!
And it's not like Dream Spawn, where Freddy's not in the book for the first half, but you're really enthralled by the characters, and you don't care that Freddy's not there. In this instance, even though it's a shorter book, you're like, just give me fucking Michael, you know?
They go on dates, they go on a drive-in. I'm expecting Michael to be in the shadows, but no, it's another guy in the shadows, and there's someone creeping in the house, and it turns out to be a worker at the house, and for the love of God, give me Michael!
Should we explain the new format so people aren't wondering what the hell's going on?
Either that or leave them in suspense.
They're going to be like, what the hell? You know, me and Sean got to talk. Wow, just drink it out of the thing, man, the pitcher.
I'm not a monster. I'm not Josh. Not you, the other Josh.
Yeah, Josh from the book, sure. We got to talking. Most of you guys have either read these books or listened to these books already, so we're not going to throw in all these clips constantly throughout the podcast. We're just going to give you the link, thumbnail at the end if you want to check it out. Plus, you know, sometimes the clips give away too much if you haven't read the book or listen to it. We don't want to spoil too much, but if you're here, you're probably going to get spoiled a little bit. It's hard to talk about the book without spoiling things. But yeah, the clips are going to be pretty much non-existent unless it's just something, wow, we got to share this, you know, this part.
I will say this right here. If any of you are listening to these videos and you would like the clips back, please let us know in the comments. We're open to suggestions, anything we can do to make this channel better. We're happy to look through the comments and take that.
Yeah, definitely. If you guys prefer having the clips, we'll put them back in. This is just, we just feel, I was looking at the analytics, and the last video I looked at, whenever I first uploaded it, the watch time for most viewers was the almost exactly the amount of time the podcast was without the clips in it. And that made me think that people were just skipping through them. But yeah, if you guys want clips back, we can maybe meet in the middle you know, maybe not throw in 5 clips for upload or whatever, but
that's what drove you away. We can be better. We can be better.
And if you're watching this, you're watching this podcast now on the 80 Slasher Library After Hours. This is going to be a completely, this is going to be a completely original content channel. I'm still going to be doing the audiobook narrations over on the 80 Slasher Librarian YouTube channel. This is a companion channel. We're going to have this podcast. We got other podcasts. We're going to have original shows. We're going to do some more Dear Stabby episodes. We're going to have a show called Hashing the Slash. Me and Sean, I'm sure we're going to have a debate on that show. It's going to be a slasher debate show. Find something I love and you hate or vice versa and debate it. So, thank you for watching on the 80 Slasher Library After Hours. Thank you for subscribing. I hope this channel keeps growing. Didn't mean to diverge too far off the path, so I digress. Hand it back over to Sean. These characters are unlikable. We don't get Michael till halfway through the book. But there is a couple interesting settings. And the mall that's being constructed, that was a good location for some... They could have used it a little better, but it had some pretty good scenes there.
Well, if we're going on the compliment sandwich, where you say something good, you say a bunch of bad stuff, and you say something good, so it kind of equalizes the sandwich. I will talk about something good before I get into this book. I feel like pumpkins were not utilized properly in the film franchise. We could have done a lot more pumpkins. First of all, spoiler alert, Michael uses a pumpkin as a Molotov cocktail in the last book. That was really cool. In this book, he uses them as ambiance and settings. It's almost as if pumpkins are a bad omen. You see a glowing pumpkin, you really need to get away fast. And I like that because it's called Halloween, and I feel like some of these books and movies just didn't do much Halloween. We can play more with the themes, but that's neither here nor there.
It's only Scream Factory, right, where witnesses see him get decapitated, yet we find out a few pages later it was a pumpkin. Nothing like that happens in this book, right?
We will soon find out if something like that happens.
I got another question. I'm going to pretend like I've never read this book, and I'm just asking. This book can't be all bad, right? It's got to have some redeemable qualities. Like, is there like this character in the book, maybe, like in a lot of the movies, where you just hate the son of a bitch and you're waiting and waiting, and finally they get their comeuppance? Tell me that happens in the book.
It happens in my ending.
No, in the book.
I really want to tell you about that, but you got to wait.
He's got a cool name, right? Josh.
So the book begins in the Myers house, which apparently is being inhabited by a family. It's kind of like the Elm Street house. You know, you never know if the house is going to be occupied. Is it abandoned? Is it haunted? I feel like each director, each writer has a different idea of where they want to take this. So
was it Nancy's house before? Was it Freddy's house before? The books are all over the place. But yeah, in the last book, this house was falling apart. It was beyond repair. In this book, they've renovated it and they're living in it.
Well, her family are, they're either real estate agents or they fix up places. Either way, I guess they are miracle workers because they made the Myers house inhabitable. Yep. And I will say this for Kelly O'Rourke writing these books. I feel like it was a natural progression to start in Haddonfield, because we've never seen a lot more of the town. It's only key parts of the neighborhood. The first one took place in City Hall. This one takes place in Michael Myers' old house. And the third one takes place in Smith's Grove. So I like the locations for these, but I feel that this book didn't evolve that concept like I kind of wanted it to. The Myers house really features as the conclusion of this book. A great portion of this book is at a diner, at a mall that's under construction. It's at a cemetery, which there are some really cool scenes that happen in that cemetery. It's just, for being called the old Myers place, I felt like that should have been more hard-hitting in the book. And I just didn't get that.
Does he have a new place? Did he get him a new house or something?
No.
Then why Barry, is the main Goldmeyer's place?
Because he used to live in, I guess.
Let's do our cast of characters here. So, who was your favorite character? My favorite character name was Julifer, just because it was weird, but she was just kind of like a thrown-in character. Didn't have a lot, you know, to do with the story. I thought Josh had more to do with the story than he did, but we got our main characters, Mary and Jeff.
Julifer was the only one I didn't want to punch in the face.
So, what were your thoughts on our main protagonists, Mary and Jeff here?
One of the things I was talking about earlier is that if you want to emotionally bond to these characters, there has to really be one character in there that you can, and I feel that the characters in this book are two-dimensional. You have Mary, who is your typical preppy teenager. She had kind of a dark past in another town, but she has reinvented herself. She's shallow. She hangs out with shallow people. She had an ex-boyfriend named Jeff. He was shallow in a different way. She meets up with this guy, Josh, who is shallow. I feel like there wasn't much depth to these characters. With Jeff, you understood a little bit more about Jeff towards the end, that he did stand up for people. He didn't want to see anyone get hurt. A lot of people picked on him because he was poor, but he did take care of the area around the cemetery. So if there's going to be depth anywhere, it was with Jeff. And I just, everybody treated Jeff like dirt in this book. Yeah. And at a certain point, I thought Michael Myers framed him, but I think that might have just been an accident. So Michael might not have done that. That kind of was an unfortunate circumstance. Jeff is just the punching bag of this entire book. I mean that literally and figuratively.
And Josh is like just one step away from being a in a certain registry or something, man. Like a sex offender. He's a sex offender in training. This guy is a creep and a cretin. And I never liked the scenes that Josh was involved in.
There's all these warning signs that he's dangerous, but he puts on this facade of being handsome, intelligent,
charming,
social charms, and you keep hearing these bad things, and you see him, you see his mask slip multiple times when he doesn't get his way, and it should be
he's a master
obvious to everyone.
It makes me feel like Kelly has known a couple sociopaths in her life,
yes,
and modeled Josh after it. I would love to ask her that because I've known some myself. But he was like the perfect sociopath.
Well, it's not just her. There is a similar character in the third book, which is Madhouse. There's an ex-girlfriend of the main character who helps him with his video equipment. And she's manipulative. She's obsessive. And I feel like there's at least one character like this in each of these books. So the dimensions of the characters seems to follow kind of like a general outline in these books. But unfortunately, books one and three had characters I could latch onto. This one really didn't. Because the main plot of this book is that Mary's in a new town, Halloween's coming around, there's going to be a party, but weird things have been happening around the house, and there's actually there is a scene in this book where Mary gets attacked by a shadow, and there's another, she knocks out the shadow, and it's Jeff, but Jeff says there was another guy doing it. Yeah. So Jeff already acted suspicious, and you're trying to figure out what's going on, because in the book, as far as the other characters go, they think Jeff is the weird guy that's sabotaging and making people disappear, and the problem is he doesn't exactly have an alibi. He's a loner. He lives outside of town. He has some emotional problems.
He's already creepy.
Right. So, unfortunately, he fits a mold that a lot of people make fun of and stereotype, which is funny because a lot of people are stereotypes in this book. And they fall into these roles, and I don't really see them evolve out of these roles, even when the conclusion wraps up.
Yeah. I almost feel like Kelly was put in a situation kind of like William was, where he had a year to write 5 books, you know?
Right.
Because the first book and the third book are great. In fact, the third book has one of the best kills, you know, the electrical one. As that's one of my favorite kills, even though we don't get the whole thing. This book has a pretty good cemetery scene, which we'll get into.
It had to be one of the best scenes.
But it seems like this book was more rushed than the other two. I don't think she had a chance to flesh it out as much as she wanted. I feel, right. feel like she had to, because each book was like exactly 150 pages, and I almost feel like that was her, that was as much as she could write. And she had so much story, but she had to confine it to that. And I think some story elements got cut. Another thing we'll get into. But yeah, Jeff is definitely marking off all, you know, checking off every box for people thinking he would be crazy or the one doing these things. And they already think he's a creep. And it's the classic, you know, the main girl falling for the bad, you know, the guy that, the outcast or whatever. You see that a lot in these books. But I did enjoy his character. He probably was the most redeeming out of all of them. Jeff was. I wish the book, actually, you know, I wish the book had centered around him instead of Mary.
I agree. And there are a couple things in this book that feel out of place for Michael Myers. I know he leaves warning signs sometimes, but there's a scene towards the latter part of the book where she loses her bracelet in a crack in the wall, and Michael finds it and gives it back to her. But this is after he's tried to kill her. So yeah. Is he just asking, I tried to kill her, I couldn't kill her. Well, will you settle for a warning? Get out of my house. But returning a bracelet doesn't exactly say, get out. I don't know what message he was trying to send. It kind of reminded me in the first book when he shoved a pumpkin into a locker and said revenge. I was, yeah. Against who? Who are you getting revenge? Like, why are you shoving pumpkins? Does no one notice a guy in a jumpsuit, a black jumpsuit with a white mask shoving pumpkins in the lockers? I don't know about your high school, but in my high school, someone would have got red flagged doing that.
Oh, they probably just thought it was the janitor. I don't know. You know how teenagers are. We weren't paying attention to everything. We could walk by a grown up and we won't even know what they look like. So it's possible. I do like the way that she discovers Michael's stuff in the basement, you know, with the closet and everything, and the bracelet falls through the hole, because that would be pretty creepy. It reminded me kind of like Jesse and the furnace in the basement and stuff in Freddy's Revenge. Right. You know, it's just like, it's just down there. So I guess Michael squatting in the house. You know, that's a running theme in these books. You know, Michael getting ran out of where he's trying to live. living in peace in the basement, people move in, you know, and he's trying to live in peace. So when this is over, he goes to the old hospital that's abandoned, tries to live in peace there, and they come and film a damn movie. So you froze up on me, man. Are you there?
You're starting to cut up. You're cutting up bad.
You were cutting up, but you're back now. But I was saying, like, in the madhouse, sorry for technical difficulties, people, listeners.
We got storms coming.
Yeah, I got storms here right now. In the madhouse, he's living in the sanitarium that's run down, and people come and disturb him. You know, same with him living in the basement of the Myers house. They come and disturb him. So it's not like he was seeking these people out. They kind of put themselves in the situation.
Right. And that always makes you wonder about the mythos. Like, what brings Michael to life? Where does he go between Halloweens? That's actually something I liked in Rob Zombie's Halloween, too. You got to see Michael, what he does for a year between kills. That was something I hadn't seen before, but that...
growing a groovy beard and mustache and hair, man.
Yeah.
Just wandering around. And it was interesting. Go ahead.
No, I'll say maybe that's something we should do. Whenever we do ratings, we should be if you give a rating lower than a 5, maybe you can say like how you would have done this differently. Okay. Because I definitely see with this book there are a couple avenues I would have wanted to take. But maybe that's something we can check out later.
Yeah, the Michael in these books is not. I'm gonna go out on a limb and just assume that these books happen in an alternate universe, you know, of Michael Myers, because he's quite different than the Michael we know in the movies.
He wears a black jumpsuit. He growls.
I do like he gets revenge on people for no reason. I do like the fact that each book talks about the events of the previous book in at least one throwaway line, right. Because you know, the previous Halloween gets mentioned in this book, as does the events of this one and the first book and the third book. But Kelly did a good job of writing 90s teens to a certain extent. There's scenes at the mall that was being constructed felt real, you know, felt like real teenagers.
They just want to bring in some beers and check the place out. I mean, you're right. That does seem realistic because a lot of the movies, going back and rewatching them, these teenagers don't really do the stuff I did as a teenager. And I know it was a different time, but...
You know, nowadays they would just text each other at the mall. But, you know, they're going there. They're hanging out. Michael's stalking them.
Michael's breaking in my house. WTF.
Oh, my God. I'm being gutted. It's getting all over my clothes.
Like, OMG.
OMFNG. You probably can hear the rain. Anyways, so what was your favorite? We don't have to go straight through here. Let's get to the first kill of the book. What did you think of the first kill that we get in this book? Tell us the first kill and your thoughts on it.
Well, the first real kill is in the mall. That's when you see Michael for the first time. He's stalking them inside the mall, and that was intense because the scene that they're in, it's mannequins. And I know the mannequins were done in the Halloween 2018 movie, but you got to think, if you're in an abandoned mall and you see all of these mannequins, and then there is a guy with a white mask that looks like a mannequin face, you wouldn't think anything of the mannequin being dressed up, but then the mannequin attacks you. When I'm in an abandoned place, I'm already on red alert. And yeah. I know they've had some beers, and they're a little more courageous, but to see a mannequin coming at you and attacking you, it was brutal, it was intense, it was scary, and those had to be the best parts of this book. When things start going down with Michael, because I feel that the adrenaline and the passion were saved for these scenes. There was three main scenes where Michael attacks, and I feel that all the fuel was saved for those scenes. Everything else in this book was coasting.
The mannequin thing made me think of the pilot episode of the newer era Doctor Who.
Right.
Remember the first episode?
Oh, the Ottens?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Anyway, so the scene was great. The mall, the event, it's like a mall under construction. They're not supposed to be there. It's the classic, not supposed to be there. Somebody gets killed. You know, people's going to find out. The mall was great, but my favorite scene in the book, including Michael Myers, was at the cemetery.
Absolutely.
Yes, that was...
On Judith Meyer's grave.
Exactly. I was going to get to that. A good throwback to the origins. We get the whole Judith Meyer's grave scene.
What's funny about that is Jeff has a... Everyone thinks Jeff attacked Mary. So at a certain point, there's this party. It's a big party towards the end where a lot of things go down. These drunken cheerleaders seem to think Jeff attacked Mary, and they're like, let's go get him. Let's go beat him out. And they see a glow in the graveyard going, that's him. And they wander in to attack him. And I guess Michael is having a memorial for Judith, or maybe he's just attracting people similar to moths to a flame. Anyone that gets near the pumpkin, he's going to kill.
Yeah.
And when Michael attacks them, he's attacking out of the fog. And I think that would have been a great scene for the movie. There are a lot of scenes, the mall scene, the cemetery scene. I would have loved to have seen these on film. So Kelly O'Rourke did a great job with these scenes. I just feel that she put all her chips into the Michael scenes and everything else just fell by the wayside.
Like, it was just, you know, connect the dots yes. with the story. But yeah, if you haven't heard the book or read the book, it's definitely worth checking out if you're a Halloween fan. The cemetery scene was great. The kills there were great. But we talked about this Josh Creed. And so there's
before you part, say that.
Yeah.
Okay, last week and this week I noticed something. In the last book we did, it was Wally and Willie. I didn't like that because they're too close together. And this one, it was Josh and Jeff. It's like, you have millions of names to pick, and you picked names that are almost the same length and the same first letter. It's really confusing. At a certain point, I forgot which character was which.
What about how Wally and Willie? Willie's real name was Wallace. And he gets called that like four, you know, it says that name like four or five times in Demon Knight. You know, so you got Wally, Willie, Wallace, Danny. It's, yeah. So anyways, the name thing does get irritating. And I've caught myself before narrating where I say the wrong name when names are similar like that. There was Rachel, and in Halloween 4, Rachel and Robert were, I think Robert was her dad's name, or Richard. I can't remember now. I just read the thing. But I would end up saying, I would look ahead to Rachel says, but I would be doing it so quick, I'd end up doing it in Richard's voice, have to go back and redo it. So it does get irritating as far as narrating goes, too. But the party scene, man, this party scene really makes you believe that Michael Myers is going to show up at this shindig and just wipe out everybody. Did you not feel like that was coming?
Yeah, I thought he was going to make a guest appearance. I mean,
what's the point? Some of the stuff that happens with Mary and the jocks and Josh, it's like, what is the point? You know, you didn't even have to have her go to this party if the rest of the book's going to take place at the Myers house. Unless Michael's coming to this party, you know, to amp up his kill count for the book, then what was the point of this? What purpose did it serve to humiliate her? Go ahead.
I was expecting, do you remember in Freddy vs. Jason when Jason's banging on the door over and over and over and the security, and he just burst the door down? Mm-hmm. I was expecting Michael to do that, banging on the door, and a drunken football player goes, "Dude, I'm coming. Boom, door comes down, crushes him. Michael goes in and just starts slashing. I mean, none of that happened. None of that.
And then Michael inadvertently neuters Josh when Josh is trying to escape being stabbed or something. But no, it doesn't happen. And that would have been the perfect death for him. But you give him a way over the kill death, which we're going to go over.
I kind of went overboard on that, but I just can't believe a guy who sexually assaults women just got away scot-free.
My line is, like, flickering. let's talk about Josh and Mary in the streets outside of the party.
So,
what leads to that point? Go ahead.
Mary tries to out Josh for what he's done to other women. He drunkenly chases her down the street to, I guess, beat her and make her submit or something, and then Julifer and them try to help, and he tries to beat them up, and then Jeff comes in, him and Jeff get into a fight, and for some reason Josh is super strong and almost kills all of them, and then the football players come to beat all of them up to back up Josh, and then they all run.
That's when Michael shows up, right?
No.
Not even away from the party, in the street. The bad guys win. Technically, the bad guys win here, and our characters leave, and everybody else is.
Do you remember in Halloween 1 when Loomis was so certain that Michael was going to come to his old house, and he didn't, and he realized he was wrong? I feel like Michael was at his house just waiting for her to show up, and then she eventually did, so then he attacked. Was he just in the bushes?
Just waiting. And Julifer, what was the story there? I'm drawing a blank here. Like, they used to be friends or something?
Julifer is Mary's cousin.
Yeah,
and cousin. They used to go to the same scenes, and then Mary changed to be preppy. So it drove a wedge between them, but Mary saves the Goss from being thrown in a pool or something, and
that's what
then they become friends again.
Yeah, and then we don't hear another thing about them or Josh.
Julifer reminds me of that truck driver from Texas Chainsaw Massacre that throws a wrench at Leatherface and just runs and never stops, and he just survives because he doesn't stop running. But Julifer did not throw anything at Michael. She never even met Michael.
Never did. All these people at the party, this whole scene, it's like a whole chapter or two. You don't hear nothing else about them. And the book goes from there to the party
for the whole book and nothing about it. I feel like we're harping on this a little bit, but it's weird.
I'm sorry, Kelly. I love your book series. I do. I love the first one and the third one. But this one, I feel like the ball was dropped a little bit as a fan of Michael. And I'm not going to be like certain other people who's like, oh, this is so stupid. It's like Michael Myers Goosebumps. No, it's not. There's blood. There's guts. There's sex. There's alcohol.
Somebody gets stabbed with a pint with a nail sticking out of it. Yeah, holy hell.
This is not watered down Michael Myers. If anything, some of this is more brutal than some of the stuff we got in some of the movies. Not part four. That one was brutal as hell.
He stabbed someone with a gun. Who does
this
that?
Is still better than Resurrection, I'll tell you that. This
that
is better
take place than, in Michael Myers' house.
Yeah, and this is better than Curse. It's not. I'm not hating on it, but there are some things that I'm like, what the actual fuck? All this stuff happens at this party, and then it goes straight to the climax of the book, taking place at the Myers house. Between you got Jeff, you got Mary, you got Michael, and get ready because that's the three characters for the rest of the book. If you were wanting a conclusion for Josh, for Julifer, the goths, the jocks at the party, you're shit out of luck. Even when I finished it, I was like, is there another epilogue? What, you know?
That's what you get for buying these off eBay. Someone stole the last 30 pages.
I scared myself, dude. I listened to it a while back again. And I think it's either this one or the Madhouse. I did a jump cut at the end where it's like a girl saying a line. I'm reading the line, and then it jumps to the next line really fast. And I was like, oh, my God, it cut out some of the dialogue, and I don't have the book anymore. But it was just I edited it too close together. I didn't drop any words. But I was like, shit, I cannot rebuy this book. It was like these books were really expensive. So, we're at the Myers house. The final showdown's happening. And regardless of the disappointment I had in the character arcs that didn't finish, Sean, I did enjoy the climax of the book. Your thoughts?
Yeah, it was a great fight between Jeff, Mary, and Michael. There is a certain moment when a heroine has to arm herself and fight her attacker. It's fight or flight, and at this point, she fought back. But as I was saying before, it didn't make her a more interesting character. It just, she attacked the bad guy and then went catatonic. It felt hollow. Yeah, I think that's the word I want to use.
It's a bit weird. I honestly felt like the ending, it felt like a lot of the story was rushed and the ending was drawn out a bit.
But it was cool. It was cool how Michael's mask kind of got melted to his face, so that could be his face now.
Yeah.
That was kind of cool. It's weird because he got some fatal attacks for himself, but he kind of walked out of it because he's Michael Myers. That's pretty much what he does. And I don't know what this book would have done for an ending. Michael just quit and went away to go live at the asylum. I mean, I feel like Michael would not have stopped killing, or is she going to convince the family to move away? Just where does Michael go?
Well, his house is burnt down now.
Okay, you're right. I forgot about that. For some reason, I thought that the fire people like got it out, but I guess they're not renovating ash.
So I really enjoyed, like you said, the mask being melted.
Yes.
So the whole time I was reading Madhouse, I was picturing that. So that's how it ends. Him pretty much just leaving. And I was disappointed with that. I was not happy with that. And I made my unhappiness clear in my commentary outro. And this is before me and Sean really talked a lot. I get an email from Sean. And, you know, I wish you could get it pulled up quick enough because I would like you to just read it. Read the ending you wrote. In fact, can you do that?
Oh, send it to you?
Can you read it?
Read the ending I wrote?
Yep.
Yeah, sure. Let me look into my files.
While he's looking into the files, I'm going to go ahead and give my rating for the book. Okay. And I'm going to give, because the book ends with Michael pretty much, the house is burning down, the characters get out by the skin of their teeth. You really think only one, I don't want to ruin it if you haven't heard it. Check out the book. There's going to be a link to the unabridged audiobook at the end of this podcast, and also a thumbnail to my narration of Sean's alternate epilogue. It's not an alternate ending, it's an alternate epilogue that takes place after the ending. A lot of stuff just seems unfinished in this book. So I can't give it anything higher than I'm going to have to give this one like a 2.5. I can't even give it a 3. I did like it. It never bored me, but it left too many things unresolved. I was not happy walking away from it. I will tell you this. I absolutely love the Madhouse, and I loved the Scream Factory. I did not love this book, so 2.5 for me.
All right, I found it.
You want to do your rating first real quick?
Yes. 2.5 out of 5, or 5 out of 10. Basically, what I loved about this book was equally weighed by what I hated in this book. So I can't give it a lower rating than that. The kills were intense. There were some creepy scenes. I love the Michael Myers scenes. They were fantastic. The cemetery, the shopping mall. I feel that if there were tweaks in this book, it could have been a lot more interesting. They could have gone more in-depth into the characters. They could have shifted the perspective. Like you said, if Jeff had been the main character, I feel like we would have gotten a better story. There were a lot of interesting things in this book, but it just didn't cut it at the end, to be completely honest. The ending did not save the rest of the book, which is something I see in a lot of horror movies where I think the ending's really good, but is a good ending worth the hour that preceded it being terrible? It's one of those things where you gotta pick your poison on that one. So that is what I'll give it. It was not a bad book. It's just I feel like there were a couple things I didn't exactly care for. So 2.5 out of 5.
And the Madhouse does more than make up for this, guys. I promise you. All right, before we end this podcast, he's going to read to you the alternate epilogue that he sent me. He knew how much I hated Josh. Out of everything, I wanted Josh's story resolved. So here it is. Alternate epilogue by Sean Campbell.
Okay, you've had a lot more experience doing these narrations, and I don't exactly have a narration voice, so I will attempt to do my best. Let's see. I had to find the file. Okay, so this is the epilogue for Halloween, The Myers House by me.
The old Myers place.
The old Myers place. I wrote it wrong in this file.
It's okay.
That's how distracted I was. Okay, so. The full moon shone dimly behind a blanket of gray, dark clouds in the sky as Jackson DeWitt stumbled out of Josh's party in a daze. A combination of ingesting many beers, chasing that freak and his lover all over town, and drinking harder back at Josh's party had left him in a heavy stupor. He fumbled in his Letterman jacket for his pack of Marlboro Lights. His vision was hazy, but as he struggled to focus his concentration on carefully fishing out one of the cigarettes from the pack, he didn't see the figure approaching from the woods. He sniffed the air in confusion. He smelt something burning, but he hadn't lit his cigarette yet. He smelled burnt plastic and rotting meat. The aroma was overpowering, but he shook his head, thinking that the alcohol had been harder on him than he thought. The crinkling of the plastic pack helped him to mask the gentle crackling of branches and dry leaves under the heavy boots of a figure in a black jumpsuit. As Jackson lit his cigarette and took a large inhale, strong hands gripped around his throat and started to squeeze like vice grips. Jackson, in a moment of primal instinct, spasmed and kicked his attacker with both feet, delivering a sharp blow to his left knee. The shape of his grip tightly, which allowed Jackson to take advantage and yanked himself from the attacker's grip. He turned to face him, but the attacker regained control of the situation by pinning Jackson against the tree. He easily lifted the football player with one tightly gripped fist, while the other hand brandished a large, blood-caked butcher's knife. With a hard, piercing jab, Michael Myers drove the knife deep into the football player. The sharpened point of the knife cut through Jackson's ribcage through his spinal cord with a hard snap. It exited out the flesh of his back, pinning him to the large oak tree outside Josh's house. Michael turned his head to the side slightly as he observed the flailing teenager starting to lose his footing as he sprang into the darkness. Michael can only see two more figures inside the house. His vision blurred from the melted plastic of his white mask. It seared to his corneas, but he could sense them. He growls, baring his fighting teeth. He surveys his surroundings for a potential weapon. He walked over to the large black iron gate that was part of a larger salmon-colored wall that spanned the length of the pool area. He gripped one of the poles and started to pull with all of his might. There was a screech of bending metal under unimaginable pressure, and it snapped as easily as plastic. The shape gripped the iron bar tightly, seething with rage as he spotted a stumbling French maid in the kitchen. She was being followed by another football player who was grabbing her arm and yelling incoherently at her.
It was a costume party. Sorry.
Yeah.
forgot to mention.
Tears ran through her mascara and her hair was disheveled. She was trying to unsuccessfully put her stiletto heels back on, but the large male took one of her shoes and threw them out on the patio. "You're such a jerk," shouted the girl, ripping her arm out of the meaty paws of the jock. She bustled onto the patio at a quickened pace. The motion sensor flooded the patio with light, illuminating the path and blinding the girl. As such, she was unaware of the menacing figure that stood behind her until she took a step backwards. She turned on a dime and peered into the blank, pale, emotionless, melted face of Michael Myers. She saw the iron bar in his hand and opened her mouth to scream. Michael raised the bar high when he was tackled from behind. "Hey, you freak, what are you doing?" cried the jock as he tried to wrestle the bar from Michael's grip. The iron pole flew from Michael's hand, damaging the patio light and turning its steady stream of light into a strobe light. Brief flashes of light illuminating the fighting figures. Michael hissed and tried to push the beefy teenager off of him. Not a difficult task, as alcohol slowed the teenager down, which would ultimately be his quick downfall. Michael quickly got to his feet and delivered a powerful kick onto the teenager's chest, shattering most of his ribs. Crimson blood squirted from his mouth as he struggled to regulate his breathing. Each breath sent razor blades into his lungs. The maid, clearly in a daze ever since she saw the football player attack the intruder, found herself awoken to consciousness as the arterial spray hit the player in her... As the arterial spray from the player hit her in the face, the warm blood shocked her back to the moment she turned to run. Michael took no chances. He wasted no time as he drove the iron pole straight through her midsection. Her eyes grew wide as the sudden realization of her predicament dawned on her. Before she could react, Michael lifted her off the ground and turned her upside down and drove the point of the stake through the chest of the football player on the ground. The two faces of the dying teenagers met as the maid slid down the pole, finally resting on top of the boy's body. They held an unwanted and horrid embrace as they died entangled in one another. Michael observed the two for a moment, tilting his head, before casting his gaze on one moving shadow in the upper window. The last teenager was finishing off a can of Pabst Blue Ribbon and clutching his hair with a grimace.
Josh!
More to go. The shape stood by the pool house before going upstairs. He reached for the dial that controlled the pool's temperature with one grimy, black hand that was stained with blood, scarred beyond belief. He slowly turned the control to its highest temperature and snapped off the control with a hard yank. The pool began to bubble and boil under a temperature of hundreds of degrees. The steam illuminated under the strobe light of a patio that was damaged by the iron pole. Josh paced in his bedroom, sipping beer and cursing that girl for refusing him, cursing Jeff for spreading lies and mistrust, cursing the football players who didn't catch the freaks. He'd get them back, though. That much was for sure. Both of them had a hard school year coming up, starting Monday. He was unaware of the large shape walking up the stairs, step by step. The shadow of the figure caught the attention of the inebriated teenager. Before he could react, Michael grabbed the teenager and lifted him off the ground as easily as he would a rag doll. Michael tossed the screaming teenager through the window pane of the balcony, and he plummeted to the ground. Josh cracked his skull against the concrete surrounding the pool. and lay beside it, blood gushing from the open wound. The blood starts to trickle into the pool, turning the foaming, steaming water bright red. As he started to regain consciousness, the figure appeared beside him, no mercy in his black eyes. "Please, please stop," begged the crying teenager, losing all composure, starting to sober up in an instant. Michael grabbed Josh by the neck with extreme prejudice and dragged his head towards the raging waters and held his head under the water. Josh flailed, waving his hands, desperately trying to wrench himself free from the monstrous grip. He couldn't move an inch as water pervaded his mouth, spilling into his throat, down into his lungs. It was only when he was within an inch of consciousness that the hands yanked him out of the water. The skin of Josh's face was bright red and blistering. He coughed and sputtered and started to choke on blood and chlorine. The shape stood over the teenager as he spasmed. He brought up his mud-caked, torn leather boot and brought it down with full force onto Josh's face, crushing his skull in. Michael looked from the teenager's mangled face up to the full moon, which was shining bright in the sky above him. His house was gone. The kids were dead. His mission complete. He was going to go home now. Back to the only other home he's ever known. Tune in next time to Halloween, the Madhouse.
Can't wait to talk about that one. Thank you for that awesome alternate ending. Wish we could have got something like that in the official book, but there will be a link if you want to hear the narration of that. And the unabridged audiobook of the Old Myers Place. Great episode. Next week, we will be doing something different. We're not going to be discussing any book in particular. We're going to be talking to Vincent DeSante from Never Hike Alone. We're going to be talking about Jason and books, films, fans, just a retrospective on Jason Voorhees and the Legend of Crystal Lake, Camp Blood. We'll talk about several different Jason books, some that we've discussed already, some we'll be discussing in the future. It's going to be a lot of fun. It's going to be a different format than we've done, and I'm looking forward to it. Vincent wants to talk a little bit about Jason Lives, which will be cool. We're still going to have our episode on that book 2 weeks and 3 weeks from now. But yeah, thanks for reading that, Sean. Thanks for writing it. Thank you, everybody, for listening. Remember, head over to After the Slash on Patreon. You can sign up for as low as $2 per month. We're about to be talking to Jason Brooks. Looking forward to that. Till next time, this has been your friendly neighborhood 80 Slasher Librarian saying, thanks for listening, and pleasant dreams!
This is Sean Campbell saying, if this one doesn't scare you, you're already dead.
Should be like two thumbnails this time. Two of them, like here and here.